now, ladies and gentlemen, Bobby Darin!
Oh, the shark baby.
Well, I first was introduced to Bobby Darin when I was a kid because my parents had a sort of incredible record collection, and I grew up listening to big bands. And so I was introduced to this kind of music, the same kind of music that Bobby Darin listened to when he was growing up, I was listening to when I was growing up, and also subsequently his albums. And for some reason when I was a kid, I just thought he was the coolest cat that ever walked the face of the earth.
Let's go make movies!
We came to Berlin initially because of the Marlene Dietrich studios at Babelsberg, enormous sound stages that go back to the 20s, and Marlene Dietrich herself shot in these rooms. What we didn't expect to find was that next door to Babelsberg studios in Potsdam was a huge Italian park where we could film all the Italian sequences. So we suddenly found that we could shoot this entire movie within 10 miles of the central Berlin.
Once I saw it, all of my apprehensions about shooting this uniquely American story that takes place in Las Vegas and the Bronx and Beverly Hills, all that apprehension went away, because what you quickly realize is that New York was hugely influenced by European design. So you'd walk into nightclubs and into recording studios that were built in the 1940s and haven't changed at all. Whereas if you were shooting in Los Angeles, you'd have to peel back four decades of change, or five decades of change. And we did a lot of clever economical things where the audience will have no idea that we go through five nightclubs in one song, and we did the entire sequence in one nightclub. So there was a lot of what Andrew Laws and I like to call tape and glue.
It became very clear that in the end, it was probably the best location to do the film. It wasn't really a compromise to do it here. And there's so much mid-century architecture in Berlin, particularly in the East, that's remained completely untouched, and locations that no one's really ever seen before.
Our first scene is in the can. Thank you very much.
First week was so hard, because we're all trying to get into it and all sort of trying to figure out our pace and our roles, from the crew to the cast. And it was 5 degrees outside, and we're faking summer in Italy. So there I am in like these tiny Sandra Dee summer dresses, supposed to be sort of skipping about, being all Sandra Dee, the youngest age, the most innocent, and my lips are blue. And so I'm trying to be like, Kate's lips are blue, we have to warm her up now, you know, we gotta take a break.
We're wearing summer clothes, you know what I mean? It's sort of, it was freezing, absolutely freezing. We had to suck ice so we didn't breathe fume. It was absolutely freezing.
Do I look like Minnie Mouse in these ears? I just wonder. How tough is it to take me seriously when I'm like this?
Well, Mickey, I think we should shoot a dance.
In order to make the dance sequences work, I couldn't learn them in pre-production, because by the time we'd shoot them, I would have forgotten them. And also, there is something about learning it, doing it. There's a level of commitment and energy that happens. So we had sort of these three dances in the beginning of the movie, middle of the movie, and the very end of the film. And it was rather nuts for me, because I'd shoot all day long, I'd go to dailies, and then at about 9 o'clock at night, I'd go to dance rehearsal, and sometimes rehearse until 11:30 at night, and then, you know, be up the next morning. And there were certainly days when I thought, how in the world am I ever going to get through this?
Kevin is naturally a dancer and a mover. I mean, it is instinct to him. And it was not difficult to teach him these particular steps, because he does understand dance and the physicality, and he has a very specific way he organizes it in his head to deliver it.
Okay, once again, please.
I did musicals for a very long time, which is the thing that, you know, people don't necessarily know about me, was that for literally from the time I was 14 until I was in my early 20s, I did musical after musical after musical after musical. So being in a musical environment for me is very comfortable. I just never done it professionally. It's not that I didn't audition for a couple of musicals, but they didn't cast me. They found little Annie all covered with ice,
still clutching her poor frozen shears. You know, I think the biggest compliment one can give him, which everybody was giving him, only because it's such a natural response, was like, wait, is that Bobby or is that you singing? Which one is that? And you never really know.
You came in a little too soon, but I mean, it makes more sense where you came in.
It's right? Like he comes in on like 5 or 6.
He comes in at a weird place. Yeah, it's on a weird place.
What was hugely important to me in terms of how the music worked was, I wasn't going to use Bobby's original tracks, and there's a very specific reason why I didn't. We would have been so locked into existing tracks that we could have never done the kind of musical numbers that we did in terms of expanding music and changing music. Also, I think an audience gets excited when they know someone's actually doing it. Where I started with the family, Bobby Darin's family, and in particular Steve Boom Boom Blauner, who is still managing Bobby Darin to this day, who's the character that John Goodman plays in the film. Boom Boom, I think, was quoted about 4.5 years ago in an article saying, over my dead body, anybody but Bobby Darin is going to sing in this movie. That's where we began. Where we ended up, after an enormous amount of discussion and shared feelings about why I wanted to do this film and what my intentions were and how I wanted to honor Bobby, was that the family, including Dodd, Darin, and Steve, went into Bobby's archives and sent to us all of his original arrangements and charts. So that's what we laid down at Abbey Road. We were doing note for note what Bobby did.
Give her the real thing.
I know my hair is falling out. I know it every goddamn day.
So the next time you go on television, wear one.
Looks so goddamn fake.
John Wayne wears one. How much more authentic can you get? Humphrey Bogart wears one.
Oh, Bogart has an album coming out, does he?
Sinatra wears one.
This was originally made. This one that you're wearing now was meant to be your youngest look.
Right.
Right. But even your youngest look, as far as we're concerned, is actually a toupee.
That is correct.
So this is actually meant to be a toupee as well. Really.
What you're always striving to do, and what I've always strived to do, is obviously make sure that people don't think anyone's wearing wigs. So when you're asked to do it, but then at the same time not make it look so bad, I don't know if you're ever going to get it right, whether you're going to actually, because we know he mentions toupees, so after a little bit in the film, we know he's wearing wigs, we know he's wearing toupees. But he didn't want them to look like toupees. But at the same time, we can't make them look completely natural. So I think we might have got there.
All Greta can talk about is my nose. I came up, I gave her a really important, major piece of direction, and about halfway through it, she went, oh my God, that's what it is, it's your nose.
She has to take a Q-tip, because the nose is made very broad, and that thins out as it gets closer to the edges, and so then you just take hot, what is it, hot water and hot witch hazel, and then she rubs off the edges so that it becomes this smooth piece, and then she makes it up. And then I have this beast upon my brow.
If it was really on my face and not an attachment.
No, I haven't seen Bob for a while.
That was my little Laurence Olivier impression. Thank you very much. I'll be here all week. Thank you.
Everybody stuck with the film, even when we went through a rough patch last summer where we weren't quite sure if it was going to happen. I mean, I was sure it was going to happen, but there were a number of other people who weren't entirely sure. And we didn't actually start shooting until November, although we were supposed to begin in June, and all these actors held in. They all didn't take other jobs. They stuck with us. And I'm so grateful that they did.
He took me to dinner and said, right, I've written it, I'm going to direct it, I'm going to play Bobby Darin, then I'm going to sing a song, then I'm going to do the dancing, then I'm, you know, yeah. He said, no, I am, I've got the money. I said, if you're going to stick your neck out that far, I'll go with you.
When Mom told me about the audition, she said, you have an audition to be Little Bobby in Beyond the Sea. And I said, and she said, you're playing young Bobby Darin. I said, is Bobby Darin the guy who did Splish Splash and all that stuff? And she said, yeah. And so then we started listening to his music a lot. I think the whole reason why Kevin wanted to make the movie was because he thought everyone should know the story of Bobby Darin.
It's just like he's possessed. He just had to do this. I've known him since 1981 when he got out of Juilliard. Whether they tossed him out or what, but he is an actor's director, and Kevin is making this work.
I may not be performing for a while. I'm going to take a little break. And as a result, I may not get a chance to publicly do something that I wanted to do for a very long time. And that is to introduce to you the woman who raised me, my mother, Nina Casado Mafia.
I have no idea that he's going to do that when he does that. And at a certain moment, they went, I'd been there all day, and they went, just literally sitting there, and they went, okay, we're going to turn the camera around. We're going to get some wild up from this point of view, and I had no idea he was going to do it. And I almost fell down, and he only told John Goodman, who was sitting next to me, and he said, John, this is really what this scene is going to be about. And then Andy came up to me and he said, Kevin really wanted to surprise you. And it was truly one of the most shocking things. And what a gift. What a gift for a director to give that to you.
Okay, thank you. Let's try that again, please.
Only people from the Bronx actually care about the Oscars.
Some moments were so painful that they became hilarious, if you know what I mean. Like sometimes in life when it's just so hard that you start to laugh out of the sheer ridiculousness of a situation. And that's sort of where the comedy comes from, is just how insane everything gets in their lives.
I know you love me, but throw the goddamn thing at me.
Oh, babe, it's gonna knock you on your ass.
Good, and try to hit me square in the middle of the back.
Okay.
Okay?
You are staying right here, because you gotta take care of Doc.
The daddy's here, he's fine! Oh.
No, you don't. No, you don't. You do not. Come back here.
Great, let's move on. Thank you very much.
There will always be, for every actor, for every entertainer, for every writer, and certainly for every director, the conflict between professional expectations and personal freedom. And Bobby faced that his entire life.
They're not ready for the new you!
They either take me as I am or I don't want them!
Bobby, in 7 years you made 10 films, won 2 Grammys, had 7 top 10 singles, got nominated for an Academy Award. What the hell more do you want?
Every time he wanted to not sit back on his laurels and just keep showing up and doing the same stuff, everybody thought he was crazy. And everybody told him he'd fail. And everybody said, you're nuts. I've experienced that a few times in my own life. And this is the film that I have been focused on for more than 5 years. In that time, I've worked. But this is where my heart and soul has been. My intention and my hope is that we'll introduce Bobby Darin to a whole generation for whom he isn't known. And quite frankly, all those guys in the sort of Rat Pack, you know, all this sort of revival in the last number of years, Bobby's been the forgotten one. And that's a real shame, because of all of them, he was probably, next to Sammy Davis Jr., the greatest nightclub entertainer we ever had.
When I was having dinner with Kevin, I went down to the John, you know, in the restaurant, and there's a guy standing there, so a young guy standing there, and I turned and said, do you ever heard of Bobby Darin? He said, yeah. He said, Bobby, my dad loved Bobby Darin. I've got all his albums. My dad left them to me. He said, oh yeah, terrific. I said, can you see Kevin Spacey playing him? He said, who's Kevin Spacey?
Oh yeah, Bobby is back.
God.